10 seconds remaining.
All right, welcome, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, to the Dota 2 Champions League season number 11, coming at you as we are getting things kicked off in this 16-team format, a best of one, though, to kick it off here in single elimination format. I love this event because we just get right into it. Talk about some diehard right from the beginning. Looking forward to having a lot of fun here. And can't wait to finally get things started in what is our first game of many to come throughout this week here, of course. So with that said, I'm Breaky CPK. I'm joined by Tsunami as my co-caster. Tsunami, welcome to the broadcast.
Yeah, it's good to be here. I didn't realize that D2CL moved so fast because I know we had casted, I guess, season 10 just a few weeks ago, and the reason I'm actually like put pieces together is because I see Cloud9 here, and I remember that Cloud9 was a somewhat notable omission from season 10, and so I was just like, wait, D2CL and Cloud9, how does that even work? But turns out that they just burn through these tournaments, make sure that every single team gets an opportunity, and well, Cloud9's back again in season 11.
Yeah, obviously, they're going to look to have a decent run, but again, it's a pretty brutal format. It really is. Like I said, start off best of one here, and it gets to best of three, of course, throughout the following rounds, but being a single elimination, I mean, it definitely comes down to the matchups here. And now, in this one, to kick it off, I do think it's safe to say Cloud9 the favorite team, but you know what? I got the chance to coincidentally cast Penta yesterday, I believe it was, for a completely different event. It was the Pro Dota Cup that's going on, and they looked really good, honestly. It was only a one-game series for them, too. They looked really good in that one game, though. So this could actually turn out to be a pretty interesting matchup here. And they're going to do it with the Wisp Juggernaut to kick things off, going up against the Centaur Ogre, though, on Cloud9. A little more typical, however.
Reserve time. Yeah, and once again, Monkey King is still first ban material. I keep seeing him banned, but I see him picked not particularly frequently. I haven't been paying too much attention to, I guess, Western Dota, though. All I know is that we saw a few Eastern Dota games, and they were not really too obsessed about the hero. But Wisp is also another hero that's not too highly prized in the Eastern scene, and it looks like Penta knows what they're getting themselves into. It wasn't banned out by Cloud9, which is typically whenever a team knows that, oh, okay, the enemy's like running IO strats, we're going to do something about it and just ban it out, or maybe we're just like equipped for it, or maybe Cloud9 just doesn't have much data on Penta, but whatever the case, they're going to let the IO go through and it gets first picked up by Penta.
Yeah, if they were watching the game yesterday, in fact, they would know that Penta perhaps likes this hero, because sure enough, he was first picked as well in that matchup. And the point I remember making, though, when I was casting them yesterday, that with the first pick, it's again, they actually did it with a Juggernaut too, so it's already kind of similar there. But then I want to say they picked up Invoker as their mid, and God, who was their offlane? I think it ended up being an Axe, actually, that went off the charts. He ended up doing amazing on the Axe. So I guess in the end, the partner ended up usually being more of the Axe when he got the Blink Dagger, of course, started to relocate and set up ganks, but not really the most traditional heroes that you usually pair a Wisp with, especially being first pick. So I found that curious, but again, they made it work yesterday. We'll see if they kind of go along that same theme here. But do you think that's almost an issue, that maybe they don't have the typical Wisp allies to go with them, or is it just fine in general as a hero?
Yeah, most of the traditional combinations have kind of fallen off. Tiny IO was the most famous one, and then CK IO was another one. Neither of those heroes are particularly meta these days, and whenever you do see IO, you typically see it in like a dual mid situation, especially with bounty runes and shrines. It just makes life so much easier for IO to get a bottle and just perpetually keep their mid at full HP. But if Penta runs something like an Invoker mid, that's probably one of the most surprising things, because aside from maybe jungle IO, I haven't seen a safe lane like support IO in quite a while. And so most of the typical combinations, I suppose, that are more viable in a safe lane are like Juggernaut, and you don't need to go full tiny IO, full CK IO, but you just pair up with any other scaling carry. Juggernaut is maybe one of my less favorite ones. Same thing with Lifestealer, as both of them have magic immunity, and so IO can't easily link up to them, especially if they're trying to go for some relocate escape plays, then usually the Life Stealer is trying to Rage out, or the Juggernaut's trying to Blade Fury out, but then that means that Io can't tether. So it's more aggressive if you want to pick this kind of combination. And if they're pairing it up with something like an Axe that you saw in the previous series, or the Invoker with that Global Sunstrike presence, then it makes sense. And it also makes sense to pick up something like a Disruptor, because Glimpse can be a very irritating counter against IO relocate moves.
If they finish with Invoker and then an Axe on top of that, it's literally the same draft as we saw yesterday, because, yeah, Disruptor was the other support now that I'm remembering, too. And they did run him in the jungle, that is, with the Wisp, to start at least. He got the Iron Talon, actually, off the bat, and then went right into the jungle. So I would expect to see similar, if not the same, here coming out. But, yeah, it's kind of funny how they just happened to cast that match yesterday. So,
I mean, you have more data than Cloud9 does.
Apparently.
I don't really know if this Ventral Spirit... I'm assuming it's going to be a carry event, just these days. I actually saw one. I was watching Manila Master Qualifiers earlier, and it was, in fact, a support Venge that I believe Wings was running, but it did not work out well. And so it's a common trend to see her put in a core role these days. And against a Juggernaut IO, I think that's pretty legitimate. Swap will be able to get her out of most bad situations, and with a strong tanky supports like Ogre and Centaur behind her, then she doesn't need to worry about getting focused too hard.
Yeah, it seems like it more success in the core, if anything. But there have, as you pointed out, there have been the occasional support option Vengefuls, which it makes sense on paper, right? You know, you got the Wave of Terror to amp damage for the team. You got the Aura on top of that to also be a nice amp for the team. And then the Swap is a decent tool in the support mindset, where you use it to save your core rather than get out as the core. But, I think Cloud9 does have history running it as a core, actually. Quite a bit, so I would lean towards that personally, but we'll see where it ends up. But I can't say I'm a prophet by any means. But
now the question is, will Invoker get last banned or not?
Yeah, 10 seconds. It's going to be interesting to see if not only Cloud9, whether they pick it or if they ban it, perhaps. Because again, I highly doubt they were happening Drow to watch Ranger. That game yesterday. But Drow Ranger Aura build,
huh? So. Probably still a core Venge, but then that kind of railroads Drow into being mid. And if it's a Drow mid, then they aren't expecting this IO jug to be mid. Because if Cloud9 doesn't know what Penta is up to, then typically whenever you see an IO jug, you're like, okay, well, that's going to be their mid match. And Drow Ranger, I feel, probably does not have the best time against that combination. Whereas she would have a much easier time against something like a solo Invoker. So, yeah, it's a... as a Drow Ranger, I'm very intimidated this game, because Juggernaut can get on you easily, Relocate can get on you easily, Axe is going to get on you easily. And if none of those heroes get on you, then Disruptor will just drag you to them. Mm-hmm. So I don't know how they're going to keep this Drow Ranger well protected outside of maybe Stampede and... theoretically Swap, but even that is not the most reliable solution. 10 seconds
remaining. Yeah, and you also kind of think about the lineup so far, the synergy. Not that it's bad, but whenever I feel like I see what we would happen to see a Drow, which lately is pretty damn rare, you would usually pair it up with another core that's pretty range heavy, right? Now, Vengeful, of course, being a range hero, if they plan to run her as a core, that is... It's not necessarily someone that has the greatest attack range in the first place, and is he really going to benefit from that ability? So I'm very intrigued by the final pick right here, as they do pin Invoker, by the way.
Yeah, they do.
All right.
And additionally, besides having a core whose range, usually we see like a offlane Weaver or some other ranged offlane that benefits from the bonus damage and can kind of get more farm in that offlane role than typical. But... It still seems like it's going to be a Centaur in the offlane. I don't think it's going to be a jungling Centaur, and now a Medusa, so I guess it's a support Venge.
Yeah, how about that? It ends up being the support Venge after all, with that final pick right there. But again, actually a hero that could most certainly benefit from that aura of the Drow Ranger special, and then you throw the Venusaur on top of that, so going to be amping some damage as well as being difficult to kill, of course, so... Shadow Fiend, though, the final pick that gives another solid core there in Penta Sports to finish things off. So, I mean, I'm looking at these lineups, and I mean, Cloud9 no doubt has a very strong lineup and whatnot, but I actually kind of like Penta's lineup with how they finished there.
Assuming that they abuse the IO properly, because if IO isn't used to its full potential, then not a very useful lane support, not a very useful 5 position, which I guess Disruptor could be the hard 5, but you would prefer this Disruptor get items over this IO getting items. And Cloud9 strategy also a bit uncharacteristic. We don't really see Drow Ranger strategies that often. Medusa will have an okay time against Shadow Fiend mid. Again, this is all dependent on what Penta's supports plan on doing in the early game. So, execution-wise, even though Cloud9's is a little bit stranger, I think theirs is easier to pull off. Go ahead.
Well, no, I'll let you finish.
Yeah, it was all just assuming that IO isn't going to be like a balling out of control IO get level 6 at like 5 minutes kind of thing.
Yeah. No, I mean, Cloud9, for me, again, I got the chance to actually cast them a couple times in the Kiv qualifiers, and even before that, they've been around, obviously, for a bit. They kind of seem like a team that's not afraid to just do different. They are not a team that will conform to what the typical trend is as far as strategy. I mean, there was one noticeable strategy that really stood out to me that, you know, way back early on the WESG back then, where they were running a support Sven pretty frequently, you know, things like that. They're not afraid to be a little bit different, so... We kind of see that here once again with such lineup, and usually more so than not, it seemed like they made it work pretty well. So we'll see if this somewhat unique draft tends to work out well here, but it is going to be that support vent. Sure enough, going to the bottom lane and getting down an aggressive ward ASAP here. Wisp does get the Iron Talon, by the way.
Okay. But you did say that last time it was like the Axe and the IO... Was it the Axe and the IO jungling together, or was it the Disruptor and the IO jungling together?
It was IO jungle by himself. Axe was in the offlane solo, was what I remember. He was in his own jungle. Now, it was on the Radiant side, so I don't know if that changes anything too massively, but until they set it up. Last game, at least.
If anything, I think the jungle for Dire is better for an IO. But yeah, we'll see. It's possible that C9 were just fully aware of this, and that's why they last banned the Invoker. And once they see that Disruptor's going to be hanging out with Juggernaut in the lane and you don't see an IO for a little bit, then Vengeful Ogre, I mean, they're great at contesting this kind of stuff. Noya has an Orb of Venom on this Ogre Magi, does not have any fear whatsoever about invading an enemy jungle, and IO jungle is heavily dependent on not getting disturbed, because you can't burst damage creeps, so if they get low, an Ogre Magi can just stand there and whack it and probably bless it.
Bounty runes controlled, no contestion on either side, just simply giving it up and going to allow the other team to pick up their appropriate rune, so 2-for-2 split. And Shadow Fiend does make his way to the middle lane. But, yeah, again, really, really analyzing these drafts here before we actually take off in this game. I'm sure you feel the same way, that Penta's going to need a good start. They're going to need to get off to an early start here and kind of have a snowball effect to look good in this game. Because if this game tapers on and, you know, continues to go in the late game, and they don't have a decent lead, if not a lead in itself, then it can start to get out of hand in favor of Cloud9, especially with the likes of Medusa. In fact, I believe we saw that the other day in one of the China matches that we happened to cast, where Medusa gets so scary, becomes this unkillable target, really.
Right.
At that point, so.
And a part of it is going to hinge on this Axe, who's getting heavily zoned at level 1.
Yeah.
If the early game doesn't go exceptional for Penta, then they can somewhat recover it, as now top lane Blade Fury onto Hestajo. Fairy like... fire to save his life.
And there's the south, so he will be fine, but yeah, damn, that was close.
Just the close. Meanwhile, Shadow Fiend is just getting bothered perpetually by Noya. So it's the early game that Penta wasn't really hoping for. They don't get that kill on the Centaur. Axe is getting heavily zoned. But as I was saying, if Axe can get some good timing on his Blink Dagger, get some pretty solid calls on the Drow Ranger or the Medusa, until Medusa does reach that maybe like 2 or 3 slot status, she's very, very vulnerable. Especially with the relocate gank being a threat, which... So far, Kot has not been bothered too much in this jungle. Ogre is more concerned about making sure that Medusa gets a good start in the mid.
Yeah, it seems like he's going to have free farm. Get level 3, then maybe come to assist the Shadow Fiend, if anything, here in the middle lane. So we'll see how that rotation works out for him. But Axe is now in the jungle himself. Obviously, as you mentioned, being bodied quite a bit at the bottom lane. Understandable. So he makes his way to the jungle, though. He has that poor man shield, so he's doing just fine. And... Not the friendliest camp right here, but...
Yeah, I don't think he can take that camp. He has that poor man's shield, but he does not have an Iron Talon, and Iron Talon gives you armor in addition to giving you that active bonus of right-clicking down creeps, and Meanwhile, Noya is on to Io's shenanigans. He's going to start invading. All the camps are down, which can verify his suspicions, and he's probably just going to start whacking away at Io if he finds him.
Yeah, and then at that point, Io basically needs to have an ally come nearby to tether two of sorts, because he could just be auto-attack down, so got to be careful with that. Top lane, they are going for the kill as he's going to be pulled back with the glimpse. This should be the first blood. Yes, he tries to TP out, but caught actually credit for the kill with the first blood using those spirits. Actually do plenty of damage, especially if you land them effectively, as he did right there. Middle lane, meanwhile, Baby Knight, he could also be in trouble. Berserkers call onto him, locking down for a short duration. Another raise, can he land it? He doesn't have mana, actually. He only had mana for one raise, and Noya stepping in, and Radix, the one that all of a sudden has to be a little bit careful. As I say that, though, Noya took some damage himself, so unfortunate that TMW didn't have enough mana right there, or else that was a kill.
Yeah, and thankfully Medusa's Shrine is still up and running. It was, I mean, the Axe got pretty lucky spins also, so it was a bit of a long shot. It would have been dependent on TMW having the mana for an additional raise, but it forced her back. She burns through a salve, so she actually still has her shrine if need be, and Noya's going to come back to protecting the mid.
Yeah, so unable to really lock down the Wisp, including getting that first blood, but he's now in the middle lane. Speaking of Wisp, supporting Shadow Fiend right here. And Shadow Fiend's the one that almost dies, though.
What a miss.
Jeez, that was close. Meanwhile, top lane, they do kill Hester Dorot once again, though. The Blade Spin of the Blade Fury.
Yeah, Blade Spin, and not even a glimpse, actually. So maybe a kinetic field that just wedged him in against a Blade Fury, yeah. Unfortunately, I mean, it's a difficult lane. You never really feel truly safe because glimpse is perpetually a threat, and this Juggernaut is maxing out his spin, so it's a lot of magic damage, and Centaur is usually good against physical damage.
And so Penta looking pretty good as far as the start from that perspective. Now, obviously when it comes to the laning in the CS, it's actually being dominated here in the middle lane by Medusa, and a lot of that thanks to Noya, I'm sure, on Ogre, as we keep referring to. He's doing a great job of bodying the Shadow Fiend right here, making it difficult. But then you have Drow, who is absolutely free farming bottom lane. And no doubt that's got to be a bit of a threat as middle lane, once again, the tourney of burning all that mana of Baby Knight. So, again, he'll be fine, but he has to pop a Manga right there, it looks like, to, in a sense, tank up a little bit more. One of the few heroes that that works for. As, okay, Khan's going to be fine. Using that tether effectively, but TMW, actually,
he's very squishy. He's pretty heavily reliant on this Io, but that means that Io's also going to be sapping levels. Baby Knight, I mean, it's not too surprising that he's dominating the lane. In addition to Ogre helping him out a lot, he's gaining 16 damage from Precision Aura right now. So it's a lot for a Shadow Fiend with very few souls to have to deal with.
Oh yeah, that's true. It is level 6 Drow now, so. How dangerous is a free farming Drow, would you say? Is that like a really scary thing that Penta's going to have to definitely deal with here in the very near future?
It's, again, going to be dependent on how well the Axe does as Centaur, and, oh, never mind, he was just double-edging creeps. Yeah, if this Axe is able to get a good blink timing, then it doesn't matter how much free farm this Ace Drow Ranger will get, because once you're able to get just a little bit of initiation off, then there's so much follow-up potential from Penta's lineup that all they need is just one good blink. But if you aren't able to ever close the gap on her, Ace is building triple bands of Elven skin right now. Probably one for the Dragonlance, one for the Yasha's in the mid lane. Noya gets the kill on Khan.
Yeah, I just caught that. It's been getting caught, actually. Noya's going to get caught himself. He gets glimpsed back in the kinetic field, but again, he's so tanky. And TMW, low alive. In fact, Disruptor's the one in trouble. One more auto attack should do the job as it does. That precision aura, man. How much? God, this Medusa's hitting so freaking hard right
34
now.
34 bonus damage right now.
Yeah.
Might get the kill.
Oh. Able to get away, though. That would have been a nice counter kill, but unable to happen. But yeah, I mean, that was a Disruptor glimpsing back the Ogre, only to be the death of him at that point. So
I'll take that as
it
tribute.
Seems like the Drow's affected, as he pointed out, that not only her individual farm, but again, that aura is definitely having huge effect, especially to this Medusa here. In the
And now she's gotten so much free farm that it's kind of difficult to come back to her lane now, because Axe, he doesn't have very much. He's not even completed his Tranquil Boots yet. Well, actually, he has, but it's in his stash. So he can't really come to this lane. Shadow Fiend has, as we've seen, been getting repeatedly harassed here. Only 19 CS for TMW, so he can't come to the bot lane. And Juggernaut can do a okay job laning against Drow Ranger, But if you give Drow Ranger a support and turn it into a 2-on-2 lane in this bot lane, then again, Juggernaut can't really stand. Ace is going to just plink away at Juggernaut, and he's not going to be able to do anything. So they're banking on Maiden, I guess, getting free farm on this Juggernaut and just being able to synergize with this IO, go for relocate ganks, and Omni slash this Drow Ranger whenever he gets one item completed, which as a Juggernaut this game, he's going to be going for a Manta style first, maybe to purge off the Drow silence, or maybe just for more damage. He glimpses back. That's to Joe.
He's trying to threaten with the hoof stomp, but that Omni Slash, it doesn't care. It just goes right on through, and that's a dead Hester Joe run yet again. So all three kills have happened to be on the Centaur. I mean, he's stressed. It is a very difficult lane up there for him, so understandable that he's finding issue.
Yeah, it's understandable, and I'm also not too concerned. Even if, I mean, he's the only source of deaths for Cloud9, and even with that, he's completed his Tranquil Boots. And so it's not that big of a deal if Axe kind of falls behind, because the rest of the team, as we see, Ace has moved up in his top lane. Ryze is only 1 point in Vengeance Aura, but still, like, Drow took down that tier 1 tower uncontested. She's going to start taking this tower uncontested, and that's two tier 1 towers at basically 8 minutes into the game.
Yeah. That's going to be a lot of objective wealth for the team of Cloud9, as that's going to be an easy tower kill up top here with no defense put up, understandably so. Going back to the Juggernaut real quickly, again, we've seen a lot of similarities from last game, so might as well reference that again. Yesterday, he did do this. He went right into the Manta style, into a Diffusal Blade, and then he actually followed that up with a Butterfly on top of that. So whether or not he's going to have the farm to necessarily go that, or this game, of course, is already much different with the starting, where they got off to a dominating start that time around this time. Not as much, and now the Gust on a Juggernaut. There's the magic missile, but he's too far away.
That build is, I don't know if he was against, I don't know who he was against that previous game, but this game has caught mid lane.
Caught, he's in trouble, but Noya gets glimpsed back, however not enough. IO will end up falling, and Baby Knight has that mana to keep him alive after a couple of raises do connect, and now Noya's going to box out TMW once again.
Right, and here. Now Ace is here in the mid lane. Yet another tower going to be pushed down. TMW has mana for one raise to draw back creep aggro, but the rest of this team isn't really ready to do this, as Ace has actually completed a Dragonland, so he outranges this tower. This is difficult. Disruptor isn't level 6, IO isn't level 6, Axe doesn't have a Blink Dagger yet, but they're going to back off.
Yeah, I feel like they're in a pretty comfortable spot. But yeah, as you're getting at, Diffusal Blade actually potentially is going to be decent here.
Exactly. The Purge is going to be useful, again, to make sure that they can close the gap onto the Drow Ranger, and then obviously when you combine it with a Manta style, that's a lot of mana burn onto Edusa, and as we've been seeing, a lot of her survivability hinges on this mana shield being up, so if they're able to close the gap and then whittle down all that mana, then again, it's all about closing, it's all about making sure that you can get on top of these ranged heroes like Medusa and Drow, and then stick to them.
Wisp right here, he's level 5, almost level 6, and we'll have that relocate coming up, but again, this is where the idea of a Wisp feels like it's a, you need to slash, you want to be using it aggressively, that relocate to set up kills, and if you're not, especially with the maybe a little bit of a slower start, it almost doesn't make the hero worthless by any means, but it definitely takes away from a first pick Wisp potential, or what they wanted it to be, so the chance here for Penta seems a little little lacking as far as the potential, I guess, of the IO. I mean, is that a concern, you think, that he is somewhat underfarmed and they really don't have that obvious, oh, now that he's level 6, let's relocate for a gank target, I guess, other than Axe, but again, he still doesn't have his Blink Dagger.
Yeah, to an extent, especially because this Medusa has basically been left alone a lot of the time, and she is a prime target for a relocate gank. Now that Medusa is, I mean, like, all the Tier 1 towers are down for Penta, that means that Cloud9 are going to be sticking together more. Ryze, instead of hanging around this Drow Ranger, is going to be able to hang around this Dusa, because I imagine that Drow Ranger, okay, she's actually going to be going for a Shadow Blade. I was wondering if she would go straight for the Pike completion or go for some other item in between. Looks like she's going to go for the Shadow Blade, and so she's a difficult target to gank. I'm not saying that invisibility is 100% reliable, but the bonus move speed that you can get from a Shadow Blade helps you get out of relocate games a little bit easier. So it's less potential for aggression from this IO for sure. And in fact, I don't even know if we'll be able to see much aggression because they don't have very much vision. Disruptor's also really under farmed. He's going to be placing a ward now in the Radiant Jungle, ideally to find relocate ganks, but the window may have passed already.
I mean, Shadow Fiend, he's going to at least finish his Power Treads right here to go with that Ring of Aquila, but we're talking about Power Treads, Ring of Aquila at 11 and a half minutes into the game for a Shadow Fiend. That's definitely not the good progress that you're hoping for. Now, again, Shadow Fiend is a hero that most certainly can recover, and ideally is starting to make that happen, but TMW slowly pushing out the bottom lane is going to realize that he'll have to fall back here. But yeah, again, going back to Juggernaut too, it's the idea of the lack of the Helm of the Dominator, frankly, on both sides yet again, unless Vengeful, is he actually, Vengeful is going for the Helm of the Dominator as I say that for Cloud9. That's a support Vengeful, remember. Still able to farm at pretty decent timing here.
Yeah, she doesn't really have much better to go for in this situation, I guess. There's no real necessity to go for something like a Medallion, because Drow Ranger has very high armor. Technically, she will lose it if she starts getting Omni Slashed, because her marksmanship bonus will go away. But still, she's an Agi hero. She wants to build agility items, so she'll have plenty of armor. Medusa, Mana Shield does not take... it's before reductions, and so even if you put the Medallion on her, you won't be helping her out very much. It looks like they want to go aggressive up top. But it's level one silence from Ace. It's more just like an empty threat. Well, he's actually maxing out the Frost Arrows.
Yeah, bottom lane, they are going to catch Vengeful Spirit, though. The Static Storm Kinetic Field combo comes out, and there's the Culling Blade to finish the job. Now Centaur, he's able to walk out despite the relocate here. And in fact, they do get the close back on Anoia, but Khan's going to end up falling right there, man. And he comes in with a spin, or Maiden even, and doing a little bit of damage, but not much of a threat. He doesn't have mana for Omni Slash now, though he does have Magic Wand charges.
Radek has his Blink Dagger if it stops getting canceled.
Yeah, it's not going to happen. Estejo Ron, that's got to feel good. After a struggle of a start, he gets a double kill here at the bottom lane. And you know what? He has his Blink Dagger. He has his Tranquil Boots. As you were mentioning earlier, was that really that big of a deal? It turned out not to be. Here for Cloud9.
Yeah, I mean, Axe was able to complete his Blink Dagger a little bit sooner, but they were used that Blink Dagger to get the kill on Vengeful Spirit, I imagine. Had to rotate all five heroes down there with a relocate gank. Had to use Static Storm, and now down goes Cat.
Oh, yeah. Catch him by himself at the bottom lane. I don't know what the plan was there. Was that a relocate?
He was putting out some spirits. He was trying to draw back aggro, but Ryze has Swap up and running now on level 7, almost 8 Vengeful Spirits, so... as this map control shrinks, as all these towers are falling, that means that you, as a support, have less room to farm.
Yeah, that seemed pretty ambitious to kind of stop this bottom lane push, especially when you knew that they were going, and they have such a great initiation between the swap and even that Blink Dagger, of course, on Centaur, and well, it ends up being the end of him. So, trying to buy more time, though, for this team to stop the ultimate sieging that's going to be happening, as four towers have now been killed. Ace, he's fine. Shadowblade, although he'll relocate. Yeah, bringing in the axe, but he's going to go for a random Berserker's Call.
Nice try. I hope Ace doesn't go back in. He's under attack. Walking around here, and there's still Omni Slash, and that was his escape from Omni Slash. He has no way of getting out of Omni Slash. His silence lasts longer than the TP. Okay, he's going to be fine.
God, yeah, he's just. I was looking at the vision there of Maiden, and yeah.
Now Raddeck nearly gets out.
Well, you know, just Shadow Blade. They do see him there as the pinks come out, but obviously he has support coming in now, so he is not too worried.
Yeah, that Shadow Blade, you only get one Shadow Blade escape. Io was already prepared with the dust, just wasn't in the right spot at the right time. They didn't go for the right read with the Axe Taunt. It's not going to be reliable anymore, and so Ace needs to stick around with his team, and I mean, that's all C9 wants to do right now. Helm of the Dominator completed on Ryze, so... their 5-man is exceptionally strong when it comes to pushing towers, which there are only 2 more Radiant's outer towers remaining tower at 15 and a half minutes in. Dyer's it's about to be only one outer tower as Ace is pushing this top one.
Pause coming out from Penta right here, but yeah, that top Noia, tower. Go ahead.
Noia is about to walk face first into a lot of unhappy stuff. He doesn't have any vision of what's going on mid.
Oh, yeah. No, that's... and they see him, don't they? So, yep. That's a dead ogre, most likely, coming out of this pause. Again, he's proven to be pretty tanky, but you got 3 heroes. I don't think they would want to use an Omni Slash right here, so it doesn't have to.
Taunt.
There we go. Here's the call. Here comes the Juggernaut to follow, the Kinetic Field, but he does have support coming in. Will he swap? mean, Noya, he is tanky. The Static Storm is going to be enough to help get the kill with the Cooling Blade cut through, but now Radek is in a little bit of trouble himself. Another Berserker Skull has that ready to go. He's trying to use it right there. He gets the taunt onto Vengeful, and in comes the Omni Slash, actually, and Centaur will fall. And now Ryze all of a sudden in a little bit of trouble. Meanwhile, Shadow Fiend going at it with Ace up here. Oh, it's not going to be enough for the turn kill as he goes down, but now Ace, one auto attack from Wei. And there we go. The Battle Hunger helping to secure the kill to him. Penta, that actually worked out pretty damn well for them. Long run.
It was a bad idea for Cloud9 to try to save the Ogre. At that point, like, they didn't see any ults being used. You just saw Taunt, and you're like, well, okay, I could save. And Vengeful was waiting. Ryze was going to use Swap like a Shallow Grave almost. Just wait until he's just, like, right at that last sliver of HP. Because as a Vengeful, you go in, you don't want to have to take Blade Fury damage yourself, and Ogre isn't going to come back into the fight anyway, so just let him get down to like as little HP as possible, and then swap him out. But then Static Storm is put on top of it, so Noya went down, and then Cloud9 filtered in one by one, and SF dying to a Drow, but then Drow dying to an Axe, that's way in favor of Penta. TMW yeah. doesn't really have that much net worth, so Drow doesn't even benefit too much from solo killing a Shadow Fiend.
And again, Shadow Fiend, as he's kind of been doing, even despite that death right there, he's been recovering. He's actually got the full Dragonlance now, and the Yasha is going to be next in line for him. So definitely going for a battle build of the right-click presence right here. And again, Juggernaut, you see him jumping up there. He's now second just behind that Drow, and it's overall pretty damn close between the cores on either side. And we talked about the potential of that Diffusal Blade as Roshan is killed, though. So C9 going to benefit from now an Aegis on a Drow Ranger here. And the Hurricane Pike to finish. Coming up soon.
Ace also wasn't able to complete that tier 2 top as a result of that fight. They're going in on Radek top, but no stun.
Yeah. Or use the Hoof Stomp, and that was an offensive need. And yeah, Disruptor gets picked off. They do kill the Healing Ward immediately, but Maiden, he's going to spin on out. Kot is going to go down right there, but Ryze standing his ground with Noya. Here comes Shadow Fiend, though. The Omni Slash speed on cooldown. Just coming off cooldown, but he can't use it in time. Oh, that would have been a Requiem, not going to go off. That's a death animation right there. Double kill for Noya in the long run. And a beautiful fight for Cloud9 is the result.
And that was without Stampede being up, and the Medusa wasn't even there. Medusa hasn't used Stone Gaze a single time this entire game. So them being able to pick out both the cores, four heroes pretty much, the Io, the Disruptor, and then Juggernaut and SF with just three heroes. That's definitely shows that C9 are in a good position and didn't even use the Aegis either.
Medusa does have a double damage rune on air, so assisting there as she came in the last bit of that fight.
This tower.
But yeah, I mean, look how hard she's hitting, especially with that DD and the precision aura. Just melts away. Nothing that Penta can do, especially without their teammates still being dead. They will resurrect now. They're going to smoke up, actually, hope to get a jump right here. But Cloud9 being smart, they've already fallen back. They're good to go, so.
And SF needs to find himself some souls as well, so. It's unlikely that they will defend this last tier 2 top, which looks like to be the next objective, unless Ace wants to do something with this Aegis, and this seems a bit risky.
Yeah. That would have been an ambitious opening right there. Really, three heroes nearby. But
if Io was on his team, then that's fine. You get some data, and then you maybe go for a relocate gank, but as a Drow Ranger, you are not a Slark. You can't really make moves like that.
No. Not yet with the farm, at least. In due time. In due time here. Wonder if that Silver Edge is going to be an option for her to think about. It seems like it could potentially be decent this game to pick up with the break effect.
Yeah, looks like he wants to go for it. I would have felt that maybe Yasha Mantis style would have been a little bit more worthwhile. It helps with your pushing potential and makes you feel a little bit less Radiant's vulnerable when going up against Juggernaut 1v1, but I guess the break? Even a break, I don't really know. Like, there's no passives worth breaking, and really Maiden on this Juggernaut doesn't care too much about it because he can just, you know, go into Omni Slash. You only lose a little bit of damage whenever you're broken, so I don't know.
What about the spins from Axe? Is that something that's, like, decent against, I guess?
Assuming he doesn't get initiated, which Kot is going to get initiated.
Yeah. He gets. I keep wanting to say he gets caught, but you know what? I'll stay away from that.
You did it once.
Don't want to overuse
it. That was all that was necessary.
Yeah. Just almost feels natural. But no, he gets found again. That's a sixth death now.
Juggernaut gets found as well. Maiden. they don't really know what's on the other side, and Hestijo doesn't have Stampede. Actually, he went for a Yules on this Centaur, as he's going to link up with Ace in this dire jungle.
Oh, Disruptor, that's going to be a quick kill for Ace. And he has that Shadow Blade coming back up. Now,
he doesn't have the mana for Omni Slash. Oh, nice,
nice
force.
Force. He gets away. Here comes Khan, actually. He ports right in top of the Centaur. As now Maiden is out of mana. The Omni Slash used, and Ace gets a double kill, meanwhile, as he picks off the IO as well. So, not the most effective Omni Slash right there. And now they're going to have to protect their base, their racks, and it's going to be difficult with no Omni Slash. Wisp is coming up in 15 seconds. It's going to drop so quickly, though.
Oh yeah, this is definitely going to drop fast, and still, like, Baby Nine has not used Stone Gaze a single time. We haven't seen the power of Cloud9's defense yet in teamfight situations. They're going to take this Rax basically uncontested. I don't blame Shadow Fiend in the slightest for trying to split push in the meantime. We'll see if they can get any glimpses, but actually, S1D probably doesn't want to start any fights. Again, Maiden does not have Omni Slash, and if you glimpse someone out, you're basically just saying, yes, please, please kill the rest of our team.
Yeah, you're making the choice for them, and it doesn't seem like it would be the best choice right there. So, although Cloud9 chooses to fall back, is actually going to have a catch over here now on the, well, more so Axe catching them, I guess, trying to, but that Yule Scepter coming into play again. Going to throw him in the air and delay this. They still want to pursue, though. Relocate not up just yet for another 20 seconds. And there's the reclaim on the Aegis, meanwhile, so... ended up not being used, but obviously still useful for the Medusa. Can put that threat, or the Drow, excuse me, the one that had it. That threat of her having it at least.
And yeah, definitely possibly helped. The high ground siege is another reason why Penta wasn't too keen on getting any sort of team fight started. But now it's down. There's like a mere fraction of map control, though. So, like we had said earlier, if this IO can't get a good start, then relocate ganks aren't really going to be a thing. They tried it once on Drow Ranger with her Shadow Blade up top, as now TMW with a Shadow Blade of his own, trying to go for a play on Ryze. Not going to get the read.
Yeah, can't really get the best opening right there. There is no fission, there's no gem, that is, on either side, so paying attention for that here. As now, yeah, the side does have that Shadow Blade, or in the case of Drow, the Silver Edge even. But could be a useful addition to the inventory of either team here. Just pick it up, but yeah, Noya's just throwing around that level 4 Bloodlust to his teammates. You already see that push potential with the Aura alone, the Precision Aura, the Wave of Terror, as well as that Vengeance Aura, but then again, the Bloodlust, so it's just, this really is a ridiculous CG team here, and you keep going back to Stone Gaze, even still yet to be used by Medusa, and that's just because it simply hasn't had to been used for C9 yet, so it's, I don't know, it's going to be such a difficult game to come back and win for Penta, but it's probably going to come down to getting a lucky catch or two. And could start at the top lane up here. They maybe catch Centaur, but no, he's keeping his distance.
Yeah, I mean, his Yule Scepter, he feels pretty safe. Yules has been being picked up more and more commonly against Axes, and I'm a big fan of that. As we saw in his initiation on Drow Ranger, it's just such a good way to not have to deal with any taunt initiation, making your team take a bunch of damage. His team will be, oh man, he was attack moving. Could go for a Requiem read.
Gonna open right there on Ace. Now, of course, he'll pop the invis, but I'm guessing they have some kind of vision, right? No, they do right there. Dust comes out. He gusts away initially, but Maiden putting in the auto attacks, and down goes Ace. So that's the kill that they were looking for. It's a bit of a pickoff to start something, but they're not out of the woods just yet, quite literally.
Nice.
IO gets hoof stomped right there. That's almost blind, I believe, and it is going to be enough for the kill as Shadow Fiend will pour it out. So they get at least one target, but not the worst casualty in the world, although Maiden, he should be fine. Yeah, no way Medusa's catching up. Well, that's a start.
It's a start, but I think that more came down to Ace overplaying his hand than it did Penta getting really good initiation, because Drow Ranger didn't need to continue walking forward after she got requiemed. The rest of her team was hanging out near the shrine because I believe Centaur was there one originally in that vicinity, and then Shadow Fiend was kind of walking after the Centaur, and then Drow Ranger just happened in the area. Ace moved north as opposed to moving towards the shrine. He gets punished for it, but yeah, Medusa has now almost overtaken Drow Ranger in net worth, so you kill one core and then another one emerges.
Yeah. Yeah, we talked about the Medusa. You're mentioning maybe really three items, and then that's where she just starts to get ridiculous, and I guess maybe almost three items. The Eye of Skadi coming along right here. Dragonlance is, I guess, kind of a half an item, but basically once she gets that Eye of Skadi, you know, that with the Lincolns, killing her is just going to be such a ridiculous task. As bottom lane killing Axe a little easier, and Drow is able to do it, just being that turret he is.
And Disruptor.
Seacott too, he sure is. Glimpse back, that's not going to save him in the end. Easy follow-up for that kill. Look at this Vengeful too, even as a Dragonlance himself. Ryze is actually becoming a bit of a semi-carry here.
Yeah, I imagine
now.
That was the plan from the beginning. It's, I guess another reason why Silver Edge is a pretty good item on the Drow Ranger is it does build out of the Ultimate Orb, which does give agility, not as much as a Manta style, but it's a cheap way to give yourself a fair amount of agility without having to spend more slots, and so Vengeful Spirit benefits out of it, and with the Dragonlance, she can also kind of siege from a distance, which only two more tier 3s remaining, and they may wait for the next Roshan. Their wave is here, and they may want to pick first, so we'll see how C9 wants to handle this.
Yeah, split push coming out from Ada meanwhile. Definitely a tactic that Penta's going to have to rely on. We saw Shadow Fiend doing it earlier. But with the IO, you know, making the use of the relocator, at least the idea of it, he's going to sit back. But if Juggernaut is to be jumped right here, he's ready to put a tether relocate on, I'm sure. He's just going to go for the spin TP, though, and that will be successful enough as IO also gets out. So, again, good pressure being put up. It's definitely part of the strategy. Relocate in onto Ryze, meanwhile. They see him over here farming some of their own agents. They're going to make him pay for that. So, nice little find again. But is now IO, where's he going back to? Back to the well? Okay, yeah, he's fine. There we go. Yeah.
Unfortunately, Ryze was left behind, and this dire ward near their secret shop caught him. But again, it's still minor. Roshan is up, but they have a medallion on the Ogre, and so, or Solar Crest actually on the Ogre, so they can very easily take it even without Vengeful. They don't have the best vision on Cloud9 right now. All they have is this ward on the south side of the map, but they feel pretty confident. They're just going to send in the Dusa. And even though I did give that three item threshold for Dusa, I suppose having a Drow Ranger on your team who is gifting 93 bonus damage right now, I guess she can kind of count as an item.
Well, and the whole team, right? I mean, when you do look at the whole makeup, it is actually a pretty well-balanced team, like I said, with the Vengeance Aura, with the Bloodlust being applied. It's ridiculous how much Medusa especially is getting amped by this team, but that's the design of the lineup, no doubt, so... having the items is just kind of extra benefit right here, and it is going to build now into that the butterfly as her next pickup. And that evasion, you talked about the Solar Crest actually being picked up in Ogre Magic, which I think has really just jumped up the tier list of items, man, that we've seen lately.
And I couldn't be more pleased, but it's mainly in response to how much physical damage lineups have gone up. Like, you don't see Glimmer Capes at all anymore because it's all about initiation by Radek.
He's trying to pull him in, but the Yules, as mentioned, coming into play. He will be relocated backwards to safety as a glimpse back as well. That Static Storm catching has to do a wrong, but he doesn't even care. There we go, the first Stone Gaze of the game, and it's doing work on the front lines. TMW, we have to turn around Hurricane Pike backwards. He got his Requiem off right there. Disruptor buys back. That's the only death so far. Radek going back in, but the quick swap from Ryze. He's going to be fine, and Axe now is going to drop in the long run. Shadow Fiend picked up, has a buyback, so does Juggernaut, who dies, but it just seems like it's a lost cause at this point. The damage of the right clicks as a team is just so ridiculous. Radek again caught in the front lines. You see TMW back here going to be forced after way. At least they got Centaur picked up, but it's just too much. A triple kill for Baby Knight. He wants more damage. He wants the Ultra kill. He wants a Rampage. He'll get the Ultra. Will he get the Rampage? No, he will not. Yeah, well, maybe give it
TMW
to him.
Be a champion, TMW.
Almost. Well, GGs are called, though. And that will do it.
Rough arrangement. You said it's single elimination BO1, and usually you let a Drow Ranger line up in through game one, and then game two, you're like, yeah, we're banning this hero. We're not letting it happen again. But you don't get a second chance. Cloud9 definitely had a very specific strategy in mind.